Got a lot of slides to get through, a lot of pictures, not a lot of theory. MR physics scares the hell out of me. I came across this quote recently, and it's since become one of my favorites. When I was a child, I used to pray every night for a new bicycle. Then I realized God doesn't work that way, so I stole one and asked him to forgive me instead. This isn't really meant to be a criticism of organized religion so much as it illustrates the point that a creative mind will always find the way around a problem. Case in point, this is just this past weekend. This is what you get when you have a very creative 4-year-old and a very understanding 10-month-old mastiff. She couldn't reach the breadbasket. He was there, and that's what you get. When I started giving talks, I promised myself I was not going to be one of those speakers who showed gratuitous pictures of his family and his pets, but as long as we're on the subject, I call this one Stay the Hell Off My Front Porch. So basically, I'm going to talk about non-contrast vascular imaging. When I first started giving these talks, I spoke about this orphan patient population who couldn't get gadolinium anymore and that this was kind of tailored specifically to them. But over the past few years, having used this in my daily practice, I'm kind of coming to the realization that this is really for everybody, and it's a wonderful solution for just about everybody. So why non-contrast and why Toshiba? I recently found out that Toshiba's been in the non-contrast vascular game for longer than anybody. They're in their second decade now. And as I understand, it was sort of a necessity is the mother of invention kind of story. Back in the day, gadolinium cost a lot of money, and apparently in Japan, the cost of the scan and the gadolinium was more than they were getting paid. So they basically had to take one vial of gadolinium, you know, use it for two people, and then kind of use it for three people, sort of ration their supply and try to make as what they had last as long as they possibly could, which was kind of the approach that my medical school roommate and I had with toilet paper and light bulbs. But eventually you get to the point where you're not getting good contrast studies because you're not given enough gadolinium. So they were sort of met with this challenge of, well, if we're getting lousy scans with contrast, can we find a way of not giving contrast at all? And here we have, you know, the NSF, the FDA finally hopped on board and made the blanket statement that, yes, gadolinium is a dangerous substance and it should not be given to everybody. It has potential risks. And of course, the bottom feeders were quick to hop on this bandwagon as well. And if you type in NSF, you get as many advertisements for law firms as you do for actual useful information. Here are the big offending agents, Omniscan, Magnavis, and Optimark. Those are the category ones, and those are the ones that are associated with the most cases of NSF. And if you go to the recent recommendations of the American College of Radiology when it comes to gadolinium, number one on the list is consider alternative examinations. I mean, it doesn't take a rocket scientist to figure that out. Yes, you can cut the dose, no more single dosing, no more triple dosing, but the bottom line is, doc, it hurts when I do this. Well, don't do that anymore. So we have these alternatives now. We don't have to give contrast. Now, non-contrast is not a new thing. I mean, we've been talking about it for years. When I was a resident, we had non-contrast studies of the renal arteries, and everybody's got them. You know, we talk about time of flight and phase contrast and SSFP. They're pretty much tools that everybody has. Like Mike Brady says, caveat emptor, buyer beware. You're going to go to RSNA, you're going to see wonderful posters, you're going to see, you know, wonderful presentations, and they're going to show you these beautiful images just like this, but you have to ask yourself, you know, who were these studies really done on? If you have to be a supermodel to get an image like this, you're going to be really surprised when Father Time comes into your apartment with a non-healing ulcer on his foot, because you're not necessarily going to get this. Toshiba has four very unique and wonderful technologies when it comes to vascular imaging. FBI and FSBI, I'm going to talk about sort of from my own personal clinical experience and show you a bunch of images for that. The time slip in the TSA, I'm going to show you some healthy volunteers that were given to me, sort of taking this baby out on the open road and showing you what it can really do. So let's talk about FBI for a second. Basically, FBI, the contrast in the vessels, relies on the phase of the cardiac cycle. That's how we get the images. Basically, during diastole, where you have slow flow in the veins and slow flow in the arteries, they're both bright. In the systolic phase, where the arterial flow is fast, only the veins are bright. You do simple mass subtraction, boom, you wind up with an arterial phase image. And this is it sort of represented, you know, with a real healthy volunteer. Here you have overlap of the iliac and pelvic arteries and veins. Here you have only the veins, and here you have the subtracted image. And here's a study from my hospital. This is early on when we were trying to figure out how to time these studies because they are cardiac gated, and that was a real challenge in the beginning. And obviously we buggered this one pretty well. We have the aorta and the cava, but you know, with time, as you practice, you get these wonderful, just absolutely beautiful images here of the aorta and the pelvic vessels. The studies that I'm going to show you that were done at my hospital, we did on the Vantage Atlas. I had the opportunity of going down to Cooper University in what is not lovely Camden, New Jersey, and seeing one of these new Titan machines. And it really is a thing of beauty, and the scans they can do are unbelievable. And it comes with a whole host of new software as well. One of the most impressive was the M-Power and this auto ECG. Talking to my lead MR tech, the biggest challenge that they had when using the old software was getting the phase of the cardiac cycle timed just right. It was manual. You had to analyze some of the images to determine exactly what the best phase of the cardiac cycle was. Now this is all completely automated. You don't have to do it at all. And it saves you 3 minutes per station. And if you're doing a four-station examination, you save 10 to 15 minutes off the scan. And in this day and age, we're all trying to be a little bit more efficient. That's a really important issue. Here's the new Titan scanner that Stuart showed, new covers, and it's got this wonderful kind of blue fiber optic light around it, which I wasn't that impressed with during, you know, when the lights were on, but when the lights went off, I looked at this thing and I was just completely mesmerized. I mean, it is absolutely beautiful. I mean, you put on side one of Pink Floyd's Dark Side of the Moon, this is basically senior year of college all over again. And Pianissimo technology is very, very quiet, but I swear I heard this thing say, "Luke, I am your father." So let's show a couple cases again. These are from my personal experience at a little company over the last couple years. First one, 53-year-old woman, 30-pack year history of smoking. That's going to be a recurring theme here. Right leg claudication. Also 1 to 2 blocks on the left. Serum creatinine 0.7. She was done originally without contrast because she was contrast phobic. So here we have, and I hope this shows pretty well from where you're sitting. Here we have this beautiful and absolutely beautiful view of the distal aorta, iliac vessels bilaterally, and here we have the corresponding angiogram. So, you know, no smoke and mirrors here. Beautifully represented is this mild narrowing of the common iliacs here. Beautifully represented is this tight common femoral lesion right here. Beautifully represented is this diffuse area of plaque in the left common femoral artery here. For those of you who may have caught me giving this talk last year, I learned the hard way that this does not make an appropriate anniversary gift. Jewelry is much better. Another case, 70-year-old woman with severe lifestyle-limiting claudication of the right lower extremity. No significant problems on the left, multiple medical problems, coronary artery disease, hypertension, again, long smoking history. Here we have, again, just a beautiful view of the aorta and pelvic vessels. Nothing too bad here. Left side looks really good. On the right side, we've got diffuse disease of the superficial femoral artery, short segment occlusion. She went to her friendly surgeon and wound up getting a right femoral popliteal bypass graft. She came back to us about a year and a half later, now has pain on the left and a little bit of pain on the right. Beautifully represented is this fempop graft here. And you can see here disease on the left here, beautiful two-vessel runoff down to the foot depicted, you know, flawlessly. And here we have just what I consider exquisite detail. And it got to the point where our surgeons weren't even asking us for angiograms anymore because they really placed a lot of validity in these non-GAD MRAs because we've shown them that there is good one-to-one correlation. The best needle is no needle. The best contrast is no contrast. And here's an image from her original study back in June of 2010. Mild narrowing here, which we didn't even mention. And also mild narrowing here, the distal femoral. And you can see here, why does she have new left-sided pain? Because she's progressed both of these lesions. And I just want to show here, traditionally, when it came to evaluating people's status post fempop bypass, you had two options. You could do non-invasive Doppler, which was pretty limited because you couldn't put the cuffs on to do pressures, or you could do a traditional angiogram. And here, you don't need to do either one. You get these beautiful images showing the proximal hood, the distal anastomosis, all the anatomy is there. If there were a problem with that graft, we would see it. Third case, 72-year-old guy with a non-healing ulcer on the dorsum of his left foot. Again, history of coronary artery disease, diabetes, hypertension. I love this slide. It's a fairly recent one. This illustrates how incredible, in my opinion, this technology is for illustrating disease. Here we have three different phases of vascular disease. We have a complete occlusion here, we've got stenosis here, and actually when I did this angiogram, I blew past this little focus of plaque here. and this patient was scheduled for a fempop bypass graft. Now, you tell a vascular surgeon that it's safe to anastomose up here, and the graft goes down a week later, and there's going to be hell to pay. And actually, when I was reviewing the MRA, because I'd planned on showing this at a conference, I saw the plaque better on the MRA than I actually did on the angio. Yeah, it's there, and the lawyers would see it, and the doctor would see it, and in retrospect, it's easy to see it. But it just goes to show you how incredible this is at illustrating all phases of disease. At my hospital, we perform all, and I've said this a million times, we perform all of our MRAs without contrast whatsoever, regardless of the patient's renal function. Why? Because we found it adds nothing but time and expense. These are two different people. They're not the same patient. But here we have a contrast-enhanced MR. Here we have FBI MR. And again, wonderfully depicted distal aorta, iliac vessels, pelvic vessels, femoral vessels, beautifully depicted here. Now you might say, well, you know, we're in the proximal pelvis, these are big vessels, you know, what about distally? Same thing. Here's a patient, actually the husband of one of our technologists, disease distal runoff, a contrast-enhanced MRA, FBI MRA. I challenge anybody to tell me which one had contrast and which one didn't. There are benefits of not giving contrast to just about everybody involved in patient care. As far as the patient is concerned, there's fewer trips to the hospital and fewer needle sticks. They have to come to the hospital once to get their blood drawn, then they have to come to the hospital again to get their procedure done. They have to get stuck to get their blood drawn, they have to get stuck to get their contrast. Non-contrast study, they don't have to get any of that. They get it all done in one visit, because nobody cares what the creatinine is. Free rescans. Now, I don't mean literally we're not charging these people, but if they get a CT angiogram and you've bolused them with 150 cc's of contrast and they move, the game is over. They're coming back another day. As long as you have the time on your schedule, if they're moving or you're having technical issues, you can keep rescanning them until you get the images that you want. And that's a wonderful thing. Because a lot of these people, they're uncomfortable. It's hard for them to hold still. Lower cost. It's about $600 less to do a non-contrast study, at least at my institution, than a contrast study, once you factor in the labs that need to be drawn and the gadolinium itself. No risk of allergic reaction. Nobody's reacting to nothing. I'm paranoid. I mean, nobody's injecting me with iodine or gadolinium unless it's absolutely necessary, especially if there's another way, and I'm here to tell you that there is another way. As far as the hospital and the physicians are concerned, you have the ability to market an extremely unique service to drive home a new patient population. You can tell your referring doctors, we can image all the vessels in your patient's body regardless of their creatinine, regardless of their allergy status, and that's an amazing thing. And this one is very important. Shorter interpretation time versus CT. Don't get me wrong, CT angios give wonderful images, but every time I see one on the reading list, I want to shove a pen in my eye because they take so long to get through. You look at the list, it's like chest x-ray, 2 images, ultrasound, 36 images, CT angio, 2004, and it takes forever to get through them. And I'm telling you, you don't get any added information. Here we have the same patient, an FBI MRA and a CTA. First of all, I don't know what's going on behind this calcium. I'll be able to find it once I plow through all the axial images and spend pretty much all afternoon doing it. Here we have one image, non-GAD MRA. I know exactly what's going on there. It's a diffusely diseased external iliac artery. Another case, same patient, different than the one we just saw. FBI MRA CTA. Wonderful, detailed anatomy. In fact, you can see this collateral arcade on both sides better than you can on a contrast study. And this is actually very important because if we're going to use balloons or if the surgeon's going to do a bypass, it's usually best to leave these big collateral arcades in place. And you can see them much better here than you can here. And again, right down here, 1 of 36, 1,270. I mean, it's just ridiculous. And the worst part is, once you finally, you know, wiped your brow off and you think you're done once you've gotten through the vessels, absolutely not. You have an entire CT of the abdomen and pelvis still left to read. And you're responsible for every liver lesion, every lymph node, every renal lesion, and the attorney is not going to care one bit that this person came in for claudication. When they come back to your hospital a year later with metastatic pancreatic cancer, you've just put another one of their kids through college. So like Tom Cruise said in the movie, show me the money. They're coming in for vascular disease. Just show me the vessels. Boom, boom, boom. I can do this all day. Boom, boom, boom. Boom, boom, boom. I could read 200 of these because this is all I need to look at. It's a war, and we're losing it. We need to maximize our efficiency and minimize our risk. Why should we set ourselves up for the risk of having to image the entire body when all we're interested in are the vessels? The next on the list of Toshiba's arsenal, what we call flow-spoiled FBI, which essentially has special gradients to allow better visualization of the slower flowing arteries, usually below the knee. Here we have an example in a healthy volunteer. Here we have from my institution. Just wonderfully detailed anatomy. And for anybody who doesn't believe it, same person, flow-spoiled FBI MRA here, the corresponding angiogram here, done, you know, relatively close to each other temporally. Nice dominant posterior tibial runoff, just shows beautifully the perineal perforators around the talus. Again, no smoke and mirrors. As far as I'm concerned, what's on the non-GAD MRA is the truth. When I talked about taking this baby out on the road, opening her up and see what she could really do, we're going to talk about some of the newer technologies that they have. Time slip imaging basically tags the blood and uses it as its own tracer to get the vascular images. These are categorized in three different ways: move in, alternate, and move out technique. And I'm going to go quickly through each one of those. In time slip, in the move in technique, basically what you do is you find the region of interest and you apply a selective IR pulse, and boom, everything goes black, basically. And I'm going to talk in very basic terms because I'm not an MR physicist and I really only understand basic. The high signal blood coming into this field, which has not been affected by that pulse, is bright. And essentially what you get are bright vessels. And the data is acquired when that high signal blood moves into the vessels of interest in the region of interest. And here we have an example of beautiful visualization of the portal venous circulation using this move-in technique. The second T-slip technique is this tag-on, tag-off, what we call the alternate technique. And basically, you apply a selective IR pulse in the region of interest, in this case, the liver, over the portal vein. And you can see here that on this, where the tag is on, the portal vein is dark. The other vessels, once the tag is off, are all bright, including the portal vein. Again, just like we did with the FBI images of the lower extremity, you do a little simple math, tag on minus tag off, and what you wind up with are really beautiful images of the portal vein. And because these are flow direction dependent, not only can you tell whether the portal vein is actually patent, but you can tell whether there's a hepatopedal or a hepatofugal flow. And we've all had situations where patients come into the hospital, and the question is there portal vein thrombosed? They go to ultrasound, and what do you get? You get about 40 images with a big, where the text literally write a question mark and portal vein, and then there's some vascular structure that's there. You don't know if it's the portal vein. You don't know which way the blood is flowing. And here, without any contrast whatsoever, you can answer the question, is the portal vein open, and which way is it flowing? And those have profound clinical implications, as we all know. The third T-slip technique, this move out, basically a non-selective IR pulse is applied to the entire field. Then a selective IR pulse is applied to the area of interest, which then basically reverses, and then these blood vessels are now bright. And these bright vessels flow out of the tagged area, and the image is acquired at a time determined by what we call the BBTI, which is the black blood time to inversion. And it's the time between the application of the T-slip pulse and the start of the data acquisition. And basically, since it's a factor of time, you can kind of extend that out. You can do it at, say, 900 milliseconds, 1100 milliseconds, 1200 milliseconds. And what you can see here on the right is as you carry this BBI time out longer, you start to opacify more of the vessels because the blood is flowing out. You've given more time for that bright blood to flow out. And here it is kind of represented here. At 900 milliseconds, you're kind of starting to get the carotid flow. At 1100, more carotid branches of the external, 1200, internal and external. And what you can kind of think of these as is sort of individual animation cells, and you can kind of see where this is going next. And if you loop them together, this is basically what you get. And you can do this angiographically as well, where you now get these wonderful sort of angiographic images of the carotid artery. So we all say in radiology, the classic dictum is, you know, one view is no view. Well, if you've only selected one point in time to image that vessel, you may be missing some very important pathology. Or you may be calling a vessel that's occluded when it's not really occluded. So by doing this, you really get to see this whole vessel temporally from start to finish. And it really, as a vascular imager, it gives just unbelievable, you know, results. Here we have, I never thought that I would live to see the day where we were doing non-contrast MRA down to the palmar and digital branches. Now, I'm not saying that every patient at this point in time who has a question of Raynaud's versus distal emboli should be going straight to non-GAD MRA, but it shows the potential of this technology, and there's no contrast involved. Just to go back to big basics, here we are, just wonderful imaging of the mesenteric vessels. Again, no contrast whatsoever. So what about the future in the next minute or so? Evaluation of pulmonary embolism in pregnant patients. I have a shift at my hospital that goes till 9 o'clock. And by the time 7 o'clock rolls around, you are beat. You just want to go home. And invariably, I would get one of two phone calls at 7:30. One, my wife asking me to stop and pick something up at the grocery store on my way home. And the second, the emergency room saying, we've got a pregnant woman here. We're worried about pulmonary embolism. And it's a hornet's nest. It's a hot potato. Nobody wants to touch. The OB-GYN is asking us, well, do you think it's really going to help? And we're saying, well, do you really think she has PE? Because let's face it, nobody wants to give a pregnant woman radiation and contrast. It's like sticking your finger in a light socket. We all know the risks, and we all know the reality. But, I mean, let's face it, you're giving two fairly dangerous things to pregnant women. There was a wonderful paper in the Journal of Pulmonary Medicine last year, which basically outlined the entire workup of PE in pregnancy. And it's not that common, but it's not uncommon either, about 10.6 per 100,000. It's the single biggest cause of maternal death. And the prevalence in patients with high risk and high clinical suspicion is 3 to 6%. So it's not something that can be laughed at. And here, just in these last two slides, I want to show you. Here is a non-contrast FBI image of the pulmonary circulation. Now, are we going to miss small subsegmental or distal segmental PEs on this? Maybe. But we miss those on CT sometimes, too. But again, there's no contrast. There's no risk. And one of the other technologies that we talked about, this time slip using this move-out technology, again, wonderful imaging of the pulmonary circulation. And you'll certainly exclude any large central pulmonary emboli. So I just wanted to thank everybody. Thank Toshiba for having me back again. In my practice over the last few years, this has had a real impact on my practice and on my patients' lives. So for me, the present has been great. And I think the future is even brighter. So thank you very much.